my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. Where there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see you with my eyes, let faith arise to you. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, we shine with glory, Lord of light, I feel alive with you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you. There is strength when I say, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Welcome to today's service. I'm Steve Bielenberg, one of the pastors at King of Kings Lutheran Church and School in Roseville, Minnesota. As I try to encourage people to be in the Word, I've collected little ways for people to remember where to find books of the Bible. Before, you know, Dr. Google was around and could tell us where everything was, people really had to depend on the table of contents, or they just were familiar enough they knew where the books fell. I've appreciated little things people have given me over the years, like Joshua judges Ruth. It's a little sentence. You'll always remember where those three books are now. When we get to the books of the New Testament, some of those letters of Paul sound an awful lot alike. And so I've collected a few things, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. You can remember General Electric Power Company. You might try Gentiles Eat Pork Chops. Or as one of my Isabels in eighth grade taught me this year, Go Eat Popcorn, which is going to be pretty popular at our house. When we get to our reading today from Philippians chapter 2, one of my favorite texts, I can't help but remember the day that I was asked to translate this from a Greek New Testament. It was during my pre-endorsement interview at the seminary, and Dr. Norman Nagel passed his Greek New Testament across the table to me and asked me to translate blind. Now I would say, oh, well, this is going to be fun. Back then I was thinking, oh, well, here goes my career. Anyway, he handed it to me, and he asked me to translate this passage from Philippians chapter 2, which talks about Jesus Christ and his humility, and that we need to model that. One of the problems in our world, and this is pervasive, is that everybody considers themselves to be first. That's not what Christ teaches us, and that's certainly not working very well for our world, whether it's the riots or politics or even the virus. Everybody somehow is me first. Jesus gave up his life for all of us. The good news is that one day, he who was first, who made himself last, even taking on death on a cross, one day, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And we celebrate that today and every day.
Bring forth the royal.
drive on this terrestrial ball. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the word, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our first reading today is from Ezekiel chapter 18, beginning at the first verse. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you mean by repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel? The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, declares the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the father, as well as the soul of the son, is mine. The soul who sins shall die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear now, O house of Israel, is my way not just? Is it not your ways that are not just? When a righteous person turns away from his righteousness and does injustice, he shall die for it. For the injustice that he has done, he shall die. Again, when a wicked person turns away from the wickedness he has committed and does what is just and right, he shall save his life. Because he considered and turned away from all the transgressions that he had committed, he shall surely live. He shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is not just. O house of Israel, are my ways not just? Is it not your ways that are not just? Therefore I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways, declares the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, lest iniquity be your ruin. Cast away from you all the transgressions that you have committed, and make yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Lord God. So turn and live. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle reading for today comes from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, starting with the second chapter. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or questioning, that you may be blameless and innocent children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And when Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came up to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus answered them, "I also will ask you one question, and if you tell me the answer, then I also will tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, from where did it come? From heaven or from man?" And they discussed it among themselves, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say from man, we're afraid of the crowd, for they all held that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." What do you think? A man had two sons, and he went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." And he answered, "I will not." But afterward he changed his mind and went. And he went to the other son and said the same. And he answered, "I go, sir," but did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly, I say to you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even when you saw it, you did not afterward change your minds and believe him." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Hi, and welcome to my home for Feeding the Lambs. If you have children at home, feel free to pause the video to discuss the questions with them. So guys, I'm going to tell you a little story this morning. That here we have the father, and here we have the son, Joe, and here's the daughter, Jane. Now, the father talked to Joe, and he says, "Hey, Joe, you know, I really need you to clean your room." Now, do you guys like it when your parents ask you to clean your room? Yeah, I never did when my parents did either. But Joe's like, "Oh yeah, Dad, I'll totally do that." And then he went and he pretended that he did that. But you know what? He wanted to go play instead. Do you guys ever do that? Where you get distracted by something else? I know I usually did. So Joe is like, oh, he'll never know that I'm not cleaning my room. And he just went over here and played and played and played, even though he told his dad he was going to do it. But, you know, now the dad comes over to Jane and says, Jane, I need you to clean your room. And Jane's like, no way, Dad, I don't want to do that. And so then she left. But you know what, later on, she was feeling pretty bad about that. And she's like, you know what, I'm going to go clean my room, even though I told my dad no way was I going to do that. So Jane went and she cleaned her room. Now, out of Joe and Jane, which one really did what the father wanted? Okay, the dad had asked them to both go clean their room. And Joe, he said, oh yeah, I'll do that, Dad. But he didn't actually do it. But Jane, on the other hand, said, no way, I'm not going to do that. But then she went and did it anyways. And so she's really the one who completed what her dad asked her to do. Because ultimately, he wanted the rooms clean, right? Well, you know, in our life too, we don't always want to do what God says, right? That there's some times where we'd rather be more like Joe and say, oh yeah, God, I'll do it. But then we get distracted by other things that we think are more fun. But you know, in our Christian walk, a lot of times we're like Jane though too, where we're like, no, God, we don't want to do it. But then God helps change our hearts and helps us to repent and to say that we're sorry for the things that we weren't supposed to do and to get back on that right path. To do what the Father wants us to do. And so in our gospel reading today, you'll hear about Jesus telling this story as well. And so we always know that God forgives us when we don't exactly do what he wants us to do, but he also helps us. He has sent the Holy Spirit to be with us to help us to do things that he wants us to do also. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the times that you forgive us when we don't do what we're supposed to do. And we also thank you for sending your Holy Spirit to help us to do the things that you want us to do. We know that on our own strength, we would never be able to live the life that you have set before us. Please help us to spread that message with others around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Grace, peace, mercy to you from God our Father, the Lord Jesus. We've been called by the gospel to be in this place of worship, to be in God's house, to be one body, to be one family in his name. Amen. My sermon today comes from our gospel reading in Matthew, making something out of nothing. So a lieutenant was walking by a soda machine, and he was looking into his pocket, and he didn't have any change. And so he saw a private coming by. And he said, hey, private, you have any change for a dollar? And the private looks into his pocket, and he says, oh, yeah, I got some change. And then lieutenant goes, is there any way for you to talk to an officer? Let's try that again, private. So the lieutenant goes, do you have any change for a dollar? And the private goes, no, sir. Okay. Now that got your attention. Now remember, no matter how high ranking you are, always be kind to the people below you, because it may or may not help you. And so that takes me into our Bible study or into the Exodus, where we remember the story in Exodus when, and most of you know the story, where Moses, with the help of God, takes the Israelites out of Egypt, out of slavery. And when they're out into slavery, and God has given them his miraculous signs and wonders, he parted the Red Sea for them. He gave them manna, he gave them quail, and then it got to the point where they're like, have you taken us into the wilderness so that we can die of thirst? We are thirsty people. That is not the first time they have squandered and frustrated Moses, and it won't be the last time. And they even wondered, is the Lord God even with us? They even questioned that. I mean, how many times did the Lord have to show them his wonders for them to stop doubting? It seems like out of this barren rock, God finally says, Moses, go to the rock and hit it. Take some elders with you, and I will give them water out of this barren rock. Out of this rock, God gave them living water that cooled them, to refresh them, to give them life. Out of death, God gives us life. And then it goes into our gospel reading today, where we see Jesus speaking to the chief priests and the elders, and they're asking Jesus, by what authority are you doing this? But Jesus goes to them and says, well, I will answer your question if you answer mine. John's baptism, is it of God or is it of man? You see, no matter how they answer this, it's going to be of God. Because if they say it is of God, then of course it's from God. If they say if it is of man, well, the people consider John to be a prophet. That's still of God. And if they say any one of those, then they have to also agree with John that says, when John saw Jesus, it says, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And they didn't want to do that. So they said, we don't know. They kept silent. They did not give an answer. It's kind of like here in America where we say, I plead the fifth. What does that mean? I don't want to say anything because I might incriminate myself. Now, just because you don't say something doesn't mean that it isn't true. And so John gives us this baptism, but Jesus says, but this baptism that I give you comes from God that will give you eternal life. So Jesus goes on to tell them this parable of two sons. One says he won't do it, and he goes and does it. One says he'll do it, and then he doesn't do it. The story has two sons, two sinners. One is obedient, and one isn't. Jesus tells the chief priests and the elders, he says, I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom ahead of you. I mean, would you imagine that? The tax collectors going ahead of you. The people that are working for the oppressive government. The prostitutes are going ahead of you. These immoral people are going into the kingdom of heaven ahead of you. They were the people group that was unworthy at that time. They were so unworthy, they wouldn't even be taken into court to be witnesses. Yet Jesus said, because of their faith, they're going to enter God's kingdom ahead of those respectable religious leaders who has condemned them. Out of a barren rock, God brings life. Out of death, God brings forth life. Out of hopeless, barren people being struck by the Spirit of God, believing and repenting, God brings forth life and makes people new. So as Moses struck this rock in the desert, water came forth. And as God strikes your heart and mind with the gospel of Jesus, he brings forth life in us, this living water that he has given us. So the question is, which one of these sons are we? Which sinner are we? See, we're all sinners. Like it or not, we're all sinners in the church. We're all in the same boat. It just matters is if we're the one that's going to listen or not to God. You know, and as I look at the world, I see a lot of hopelessness. You know, especially when it comes to our brothers and sisters who are coming out of prison, who has committed a crime. And you look at this and you say, well, you know, I get it. These are scary people. They're criminals. They went to prison for a reason. There's a reason why we are scared of them. These are the people who has been ostracized in our times. Some states won't even allow them to vote. These are the people that some of us says, well, you know, they are beyond help. They're hopeless. What can we expect from these people? They're just going to do it again, so why should we even help them? But we think about it. Think about what would Jesus say about these people? Jesus goes on to tell the story, parable in our gospel today. There are two brothers. One says he'll do it and doesn't do it, and the other one says he won't do it, but eventually he does. Which one are you? See, we're all in the same boat. The tax collectors, the religious leaders, the Christians, the prostitute, the ex-prisoners. We're all just a bunch of sinners. The only difference is some of us says we'll do it and then we don't. Some of us says we won't do it and eventually we do, because we see the need to be repentant. And we are obedient, and we listen to God's word. See, we must see our sinfulness. We must repent, and we must believe. And so that when we are struck by the power of God, by the Spirit of God, this hope that fills in us, that this gushing living water comes out of us. Just like God takes this barren rock and brings out forth living water for the people. Now, speaking of being in the same boat, you know, I have friends from all spectrums of life. One of my best friends is a doctor, and we grew up together in elementary. And another one of my best friends, he did 25 years in prison for killing someone. These are the spectrums of the people that I know, and they're both my best friends. How do I look at them? Do I put the doctor in front of the person that was a murderer, that killed someone? I see them through the cross eye of Jesus, because Jesus says, I died for them both. Now, recently, I had a friend that gave me a call, and we were friends since high school, too. And he called me out of the blue, and we were talking, and he says, Vu, I just want to let you know that I'm dying. I said, what do you have? He says, I've got cancer, and the doctor has given me 1 year to live. He says, I wanted to know about this Jesus. I want to know about God. He says, I want you to baptize me because I don't have much time and I don't want to go to hell. And we talked for a long time. And he says, your perspective on life changes when the doctor gives you no more than a year to live. Now, what do we do with that? I mean, if you had a friend that only had a year left to live, how do you spend time with them? How do you tell them about Jesus? Do you wait? Or do you spend more time with them so that you can show them God's love? That gives us perspective in life when you have only 1 year left to live. And then recently, I was talking to some junior highs, and I was trying to get to them to understand this. It says, what is the purpose of life? What is the purpose of your life? And eventually, they got it. They're like, the purpose of our life is to share God's love. The purpose of our life is to share the good news of Jesus. That's all of our purpose. All of us who are believers, that is our main purpose, is to share the love of God. Now, what we have to figure out is, how do we do that? Each one of us has our own different gifts on how to do that. One of them says, well, since I'm an introvert, I can share the word of God through social media, through the computer with my friends. One of them says, I can share the word of God through everything that I do. You know, Robert Wickham, he's a chaplain for inmates in Benzie County Prison in Michigan. He's 67 years old now, and he's a chaplain there. But before he was a chaplain, he was an inmate. And he went in there for 4 years for having drug and alcohol abuse. He dropped out of high school. I mean, he's had a rough life. And then back in 2017, he went back there again. And he says, once he got out, he says, I'm not sure if I want to go back in there. And so he got connected with a church that helps prisoners so that they don't go back into prison. And eventually, he felt the calling to become a chaplain so that he can go back and help the same people that he was with there in the first place. We see them as tax collectors, as prostitutes. We see them as felons. God saw a son who for many years said, I'm not going to do it. And then eventually, he did. I mean, I wonder what many of us who's got friends that may be going down that same road, and how can we help lead them to change that life? It says, you know, so many years I'm not going to do God's work. So many years I don't believe. But how can we help them with that? And so to the chief priests and to the elders of the people who came to Jesus and questioned Jesus' authority, this is what Jesus said. He says, I tell you the truth that the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you, for John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him. You did not repent and you did not believe him. When the thirsty Israelites were giving Moses a hard time, Moses cried out, "What am I going to do with these people, Lord? What am I going to do?" And sometimes in life, we say the same thing to those who are around us, those who are ostracized, those that we don't want to work with. What am I going to do with these people? God says, walk ahead of the people. Take out some of your elders and Israelites and take in your hand the staff which you struck the Nile and go and stand before them and hit the rock at Horeb and strike the rock and water will come out of it for the people to drink. And so when we look at our community, our world, we see nothing but hopelessness. We see nothing but dry, barren rocks, but we go out there. God tells us to go out there and strike it with the gospel so that the living water may come out of the dry, barren, hopeless community that we see that are so thirsty for something, but that they need this living water. And so we are to trust the Lord that He is going to go ahead of us, among us, and that He can stand before us. And He's going to say, go ahead, strike, and something will come out. You will see my miracle. And so I invite you to come out. I invite you to see and to work in the Lord's vineyard. Some of you might say, I will not go. But there will come a time where you're going to have to say, I will go. And I hope that time is now, that now is the time. And when Jesus walked here on earth, and He went from town to town to village, preaching the kingdom of God, and He saw people who were helpless, people who He had compassion for because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and He went and loved on them. And we live in this world who needs Jesus more than ever. People are standing around waiting for something. It's our job to go out there and show them this Jesus. They're demanding water. We have this water of living water that gives eternal life. God provides this water for us. It's for us to take this water and share it. And so through Jesus Christ, this rock that we have, that Jesus is the rock that we have of salvation, this rock that used to have no water, and when you hit it, water comes out, that Jesus is this rock. He's our foundation. We share this with our neighbors, and we have that. So for those of us who have it, go. Now's the time. You might say, well, I'm not ready to go. The time will come where you'll be ready to go. Because we're all in the same boat. We're all sinners. The question is, which one are you? Which one of you will go? And if you don't know Jesus, you have not gone, I invite you to know Jesus. I invite you to call one of us, one of the pastors here at King of Kings, and we will show you who Jesus is. Now I pray that the grace of God be with you, that the power of the Holy Spirit lead you, and the resurrection of Jesus give you peace, forgiveness, and new life. Amen.
We confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day, He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, merciful Father, we thank You and we praise You that You have given us Your Son, Jesus Christ, who poured out His life for each and every one of us. We ask, Lord, that You would help us to follow that example of humility that He has set. We ask that You would help us to be like the Son in today's gospel reading who went and did His Father's bidding. We know, Lord, that's not always the easiest path, but we pray that You would let Your Holy Spirit lead us and guide us, that You would encourage us by the brothers and sisters in Christ You've put about us, and that You would help us truly to do Your will. We thank You and we praise You for the forgiveness You give to us as Your people. And we ask, Lord, that You would help us to be gracious and merciful and forgiving to the people that You've put in our lives. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, your word calls us to rejoice with those who rejoice. And this week, we rejoice with Veda Rosetta, a daughter of Sid and Brandy Coleman, as she was baptized last Sunday. We thank you for all the gifts you gave to her in her baptism, and we ask that you would help each of us to remember that we are forgiven, and you've given us faith, and you've given us the promise of eternal life. We ask, Lord, that you would be with Martha Fritz and the Reverend Lawson Short as they were married last Friday. We thank you for that beautiful and joyful day for them and for their family. We ask that you would watch over them and bless them in their life together. And we pray, Lord, that you would pour every blessing upon them. We ask that you'd be with Jim and Doreen Preem as they celebrated their 56th wedding anniversary recently. We thank you for all those years of love and care. And we ask now that you would continue to watch over them as they visit their doctors and they've got family members they're concerned about. We pray, Lord, you would continue to let your hand of blessing and comfort remain on their house. We pray, Lord, that you'd be with all those who celebrate birthdays and anniversaries and other good things this week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who need your healing. We pray for those that we name aloud and those that we name silently in our hearts. We pray for the Reverend Bob Cordes as he is expecting surgery or eye surgery this week. We pray that that has all gone well. We ask that you would be with our sister, Diane Murdoch, following hip replacement surgery on Tuesday. We pray, Lord, that this would be a solution and an answer to many prayers. We ask that you'd be with Sandy Burwell following knee surgery on Tuesday. And we pray that this is successful and that it would continue to help her as she lives her life for you. We pray that you would be with Kara Colmer as she begins physical therapy. We thank you for the progress that she has made so far and ask that that would continue. We ask that you would be with our sister Ramona Kramer, who is at home. We pray that you'd be with Dr. Steve Stolman and all who battle with Parkinson's. That you'd be with all those who also care for them. We pray that you'd be with Carol Grothier's sister-in-law, Shira Joy, as she recuperates from shoulder surgery and a broken foot. We pray for Kelly Lang, who had back surgery at Mercy Hospital. We pray, Lord, that this would be a solution for her. We pray for Cao Yang, who had been hospitalized recently, and that you'd be with our brother Puma as he continues to care for his mother. Be with Donna Fries as she has many health concerns. Continue to be with Zach Schuster's mother, Karen, and her husband, Ken, as they continue to consult with doctors and see what they are able to do. We pray, Lord, also that you would be with the many people we know who battle with dementia and Alzheimer's and all those who take care of them. We ask, Lord, that you would give them grace and mercy during these difficult times in their families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you would lay your hand of hope and healing upon all those who struggle in the battle with cancer. Be with the little ones, Madison and Olivia and Braden, as they continue to receive treatment. Be with John and Ann Curry as she is receiving treatment at the Mayo Clinic right now. Be with Jerry Eldahl's brother, Paul, as he receives treatment for kidney cancer. Be with Jen Dagner, Sandy Weingarten, Shelley Preem, and Larry Hexham, as they continue to consult doctors and receive treatments. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, that you would be with those who are affected by COVID-19. We pray that you'd be with Mike Bucher, who's been diagnosed with it and is hospitalized, the cousin of Bernice Magnuson. Because of the other things that he has, we pray, Lord, that you would be watchful over him and that you would pull him through this. We thank you that you have been with Dr. Mark Press and Reverend Al Franzmeier as they have returned home and are recuperating from this. We pray for your gentle care and mercy in their lives. We pray, Lord, that you would be with all those who work towards a cure for all those people who are quarantined right now, that you'd be with healthcare workers and senior living staff, that you would be with teachers and administrators and all those who work during this difficult time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, for your love and your care for all those who grieve. As we rejoice with those who rejoice, we also weep with those who weep. We pray that you will be with the family and the friends of David Laird, who is a lifelong friend of our brother Doug Hartford. Be with his family and comfort them with the promise of the resurrection. Be with the family and friends of Concordia University Emeritus Professor of English John Solenston. We ask that you'd be with this family and that you would be with them as they make arrangements. It's a difficult time for these things to happen, and we pray that you would be with them and help them to have grace and mercy at the palm of your hand. We pray, Lord, that you would be with all those who are in harm's way or who have survived it because of hurricanes in the south, those people who are affected by fires throughout the western part of our country. In the face of all these things, Lord, help us be still and know that you are God. You lift your voice. The earth melts, it tells us in the Psalms. Help us to know that all these things are in your hands. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to be with the church on earth, the church militant, which continues to fight. We pray, Lord, that you would be with the staff and families of Trinity First, our sister congregation and school in Minneapolis. As they live and work each day in a very challenging neighborhood, we pray, Lord, that you would protect the families, that you would protect the teachers, that you'd protect the staff and all who enter there. We pray, Lord, that you would be with those who continue to proclaim your word around the world. We trust that you'll be with Jim and Sue Kaiser as they return to Ethiopia on October 2nd. As they work for Lutheran Bible translators and as they continue to bring your word into the languages of people who have never had that word on their own, we pray, Lord, that you would bring joy and success to them and the teams they work with as they continue to bring the gospel into the lives of new people. So we pray for safe passage and Godspeed as they travel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Died and rose on high, who died eternal.
And now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Hello, my name is Pastor Lee, one of the pastors here at King of Kings Lutheran Church and School here in Roseville, Minnesota. As I was writing my sermon and I was practicing it, and right before we were going to record this today, we had a knock on our church door, and there was someone asking for help. And right in the middle of me, still looking over my sermon notes, and the first thought came to me was, oh, I'm in the middle of my sermon trying to go through it, and I'm being interrupted. And then I had to take a step back and said, wait, what am I doing? This is someone that's looking for help. These are the same people that I was preaching about, that I was going to preach about. And so I put my paper down, and I spoke to this gentleman for about 20, 30 minutes. And it was even time for me to come in and record my sermon, and I was like 15 minutes late, and everybody was waiting for me. But I was talking to this gentleman who needed help, the same people that I was going to preach on, that God brought him to me. And I hope that it becomes fruitful. I hope that opportunity comes to you, that the first moment you're like, oh, what am I doing? And then you take a step back and say, wait a minute, this is what I was praying for. This is what I was talking about. That God brought somebody to me right in front of me. And that was my opportunity to show them God's love. So I pray that today, that message and the worship service has encouraged you, has inspired you, has uplifted you to know about Jesus, but also empowers you to go and share God's good news. And may God open up doors to give you that opportunity. We'll see you next week. Thanks for watching.
to the doubting heart, end of the wars. Mercy to sinners, light of the world, all power and authority, Lord, speak your word. Peace on earth, Lord, hear our prayer, your peace on earth.